butcher on the street right there.
Most of them were strangers, 168 high school students from different schools and different worlds. They represented every race, religion, and culture, all headed to a summer camp for reasons as diverse as they were.
I've never been camping, you know.
They said it was for 5 credits.
My friend said it was a lot of fun, so I said, okay, why not?
I thought it'd be interesting.
My mom made me. No, I'm kidding.
They had no idea what was really to come.
I'm Sylvia Lopez. Every summer for the past 39 years, teenagers from all over Southern California come here to a week-long camp in the San Bernardino Mountains. It's called Brotherhood-Sisterhood USA, and it gives teens a deep look into their innermost thoughts and beliefs. They tackle tough issues like racism, sexual stereotyping, religious bigotry, and attitudes towards the disabled. The process is painful and powerful, and it changes their lives forever.
I'm Lori Nelson, and the Director of Youth Education Programs for the NCCJ.
The goal of the first day that we're here is really to start getting acquainted with each other, get acquainted with the environment, and start preparing for the dialogue that we're going to have. We need for them to feel safe. We're asking them to take some real risks.
If anyone knows all about this camp, it's Lori Nelson. 10 years ago, she was one of the campers sitting in this same room for the very first time.
I thought we would go and have discussions and then play some volleyball, and I really had no idea what I was getting myself into.
Just getting here was an accomplishment. Applications are accepted on a first-come, first-served basis, and there was a waiting list of nearly 100. Some of these teens were recruited by their teachers, others by former campers.
I had friends who came and came back to my house just saying, oh my God, you know. And I couldn't really relate to what they were saying, but I knew something really special happened to them.
At 15 years old, Susan Goldberg is already a mover and shaker. Not long ago, she and other members of the LA Student Coalition participated in a sit-in at the South African consulate to protest apartheid. She came to camp to examine prejudice in a more personal way.
I was really curious what it was going to do to me.
Jay Taylor arrived feeling the pain that racism creates.
There's not a day that goes by where you don't walk down the street where somebody's calling you nigger or somebody's getting beat up. Like 2 days before I came here, I was chased by skinheads.
We are going to try to build a community that may be different from the community that you're coming from.
And to do that, Lori has assembled a multiracial, multicultural staff led by 2 co-directors.
And that's Henry Aronson, right here. I have Leisha Brooks.
Back down the hill, Leisha teaches 5th grade in South Central LA. Like Lori, she is a former camper. Henry started on staff last summer with a deep conviction that self-knowledge is essential to mutual understanding.
Racism is not out there, it's here. You know, sexism is not out there, it's right in here.
Our main focus is to get you at a place where you can look at who you are. And so you can get to a place to see who I am.
And the campers got right to work doing that in small dialogue groups.
Who are you?
I'm Kareem El Safi.
Who are you?
I'm Kareem El Safi.
Who are you?
I'm Kareem El Safi from Santa Monica.
I was thinking that you didn't really know who you were because you kept saying your name, and I knew your name, but I didn't know what kind of person you were as far as the qualities.
That night, when they got to their cabins, some campers, like Melissa Chavarria, were confused and not entirely sure they wanted to stay.
Tension, frustration, just a lot of, I had a lot of mixed feelings today. I think I felt everything today, you know.
Hey, hey, check it out, check it out. I'm pulling numbers like there's no tomorrow. Look at this. That girl on my jock, I got it.
But the next morning, they started enjoying themselves again, thanks to some all-too-familiar role-playing.
I was sitting in the cafeteria, and I was listening to these guys talk. I couldn't believe it. One of them was talking about these women like they were dogs.
Someone explained to me what Anton and Allie were talking about.
Yeah. Basically, it seemed like they were trying to impress each other by saying how many girls they could get.
But after lunch, they got a surprise.
Shall you wait? Shall you wait? Shall you wait?
They had entered the world of the immigrant, unable to understand what was asked of them, unable to read the papers they were supposed to fill out.
How do you know what's wrong?
I don't know what's wrong.
The campers struggled with one obstacle after another.
Oh, come on!
Until it was all over.
There was a lot of that frightened rabbit look, like, I've got to get out of here. This is really getting to me.
It was a trip, though, because I guess now I know how you feel.
And this time, when they went to their dialogue groups, something happened. They began to share secrets about themselves. There was Fifi Kelly Chang, a refugee who escaped from Vietnam with her father.
Like, I'm a limbo now. I'm in a limbo. I'm in the middle of nowhere. And I don't know what I am. My mom, she's in Vietnam, and my dad's an American citizen now. And I'm not.
Dan Hawley, a former member of Skinheads Against Racial Prejudice, says his own grandfather doesn't understand that he's fighting racism.
He was telling the family that because I was a skinhead, I was a bad kid and I needed counseling. That's why I'm up. And he's the one saying the Jews are taking over the country.
When the entire camp met again, the confidences they shared had brought them closer, and they eagerly embraced the idea of becoming a multiracial, multicultural community.
Are you willing to become a community? Are you willing to become part of this process this week? It's not going to be easy. Pulling together, I think we can. Give yourself a...
And out on the volleyball court, they gave it their best shot. Campers of all races and backgrounds dancing together as they never had before. Whether it was a folk dance or a silly song about a duck, they were having the time of their lives. Campers had made new friends, and they thought their goal of becoming a multiracial, multicultural community was already a reality. But on day three, they began to see just how far they still had to go.
So you devote more time to studying or being with your friends?
What's your favorite subject?
What type of people do you hang around with?
It looked like a game show, each teen trying to identify which panelist was a poor student, homecoming queen, and so on. But the campers' questions were going to teach them something about themselves.
The questions were formed, in my opinion, upon your stereotypes of what you thought that particular teen was.
In their dialogue groups, they realized how hurtful it is when someone stereotypes them.
Like my mom used to tell me, why do you stereotype yourself as a skinhead when you know all, you know, when people think of skinheads, they think of racial. You know, I'd walk by a Hispanic person or a black person and I'd say, hey, what's up? And they'd like give me a dirty look and walk off.
Honestly, if you still had your head shaved and you came in with Doc Martens, I wouldn't talk to you.
See, that's the reason I got out of it. I was getting hassled all the time. Mm-hmm. There's gotta be more communication, more talking between us all.
And that realization made the next exercise especially difficult. Some of the campers wore gags to make them mute. Others were told to imagine being blind, deaf, paralyzed, or that they'd lost limbs. It was very painful for Susan, whose sister is deaf.
It was the first time.
Oh, God.
It was the first time I put myself in her place.
Lori and Leisha, who devised this exercise, sat on the side watching.
We had no idea that it would be that impacting. I sometimes was torn when I see the kids go through the struggles and, you know, they're upset and they're crying. But I think that I'd rather it happen here, you know, with people that really care about them and where we can talk about it, and also hope that once they get out there, they'll start changing things.
The final exercise of this day helped the campers see how stereotypes lead to prejudice. While the Jewish campers and staff waited on stage, all the other campers made lists of stereotypes they've had about Jews.
Not generous.
Stingy. Snobby.
They have a large control of the media.
Okay, control of the media.
Listening to those words in the same room where they pledged to form a multicultural community just the night before was devastating.
I sometimes wonder how people could be so cold and so cold-hearted just because you're another race or another creed.
And when the campers looked at some current anti-Semitic hate literature containing some of the same words they had chosen, they realized with shame what they had done. It was just a preview of what was ahead.
What are some of the stereotypes that we have about Latinos? Again, these are stereotypes that we as a black group have about them, and we're going to share them with them.
Very violent.
Very violent.
Drug users.
Drug users.
It was the morning of day four, and all the campers were divided into five racial groups: black African American, Latino, white, Native American, and Asian Pacific Islander. They listed their stereotypes of all the other races, and they were brutally honest.
What do you think of white people?
Anybody.
Stuck up.
Surfers.
Supremacists.
The races met two at a time, each posting their lists about the other, and the confrontations began. Heather Pulte is a Native American.
We were put on reservations. We did not like it, okay?
Now you have the choice to live anywhere you want, and there's still Native Americans living in a reservation, so that's where I got my stereotype from.
I'm very
stereotyped. I'm appalled because I don't think I stink. I don't think any of us do. I'm really pissed off because these are my friends who are putting these judgments on me.
I think I really want to hear about taking money from the black community.
The Asian people who own businesses in the black community don't live in the black community.
I got that a lot from a lot of the blacks that I work with, that the Asians are all coming in here and your people, you guys, are taking the money away from me. You personally.
When Latinos and blacks faced off, Jay simply couldn't take it anymore. But Melissa made a breakthrough.
I have one of the experience with a person, and I make an assumption about everybody that isn't right, and I really am sorry if I offended you.
Okay. The white campers came out of the rotations upset and confused.
I want to learn. I want to learn about these things. I want to learn how to communicate. And it's so hard when I don't know their pain.
When everyone went to their dialogue groups to sort things out, they wondered if this camp could survive the name-calling and prejudice they'd just faced. As day four continued, the campers were confused, angry, and terribly hurt. Some of their friends had said things that shook them, and the pain wasn't over yet. Worn out emotionally, the campers perked up with what seemed to be an intellectual assignment, ranking the five races from most to least powerful in government.
We decided that it would be whites, blacks, Latinos, Asians, and Native Americans.
But it wasn't intellectual anymore when Leisha had them form a living power grid.
Need the white group to take the stage, please?
Then, one by one, the other races took their positions. Black African Americans, Latinos, Asian Pacific Islanders, and last of all, Native Americans. It was the final blow. They realized not only what they thought of each other, but how society views them.
Well, we've got to take responsibility for this, because this is called racism. If we just take one stand, if we begin to stand up for each other, we can do something about it. Does that make sense?
And in the midst of their misery, it did begin to make sense.
Someone's hurting my love.
That night when they sang around the campfire, you could feel their pain. They hated the things they had said and the things that had been said about them. In their sorrow, they swore nothing would divide them again. But early the next morning, they were divided. The women campers formed a tunnel from a cabin to the main lodge. A tunnel that every male camper, youth leader, and staff member had to walk through while the women catcalled the men. It was an exercise in sexual dominance and intimidation. Some of the men didn't take it seriously, and that infuriated the women.
And it's over.
I shouldn't have to walk down the street and always look back to see if there's somebody following me. And I shouldn't have to feel fear.
When the men met separately, some of them couldn't understand why the women were so upset.
We're guys, man. We're, you know, it's not that wrong with
just talking
to me. I'm not talking about derogatory or anything like that.
But others felt that by catcalling any woman, they were demeaning them all.
I don't know what to do to get this across to other men that could whip the shit out of me.
When they got back together in the main lodge, many of the men were still struggling with emotions they weren't used to. And when Susan's brother David apologized for being insensitive, she answered for all the women in the room.
I don't want you to apologize to me. That's not what I want you to do. I don't know. I just want you to learn. But I don't know what I want. I want you to change.
It was at that moment that the campers realized how much they all had changed in the last 5 days, and they couldn't stop wondering if the pain they were feeling would be worth it. Is almost over and the process is beginning to shift gears. After all the looking inward and focusing on this community, it's time to get ready to go down the hill and back home.
My family unit is broken down right now because my father just recently died.
The campers talked about personal issues at home that are affecting them and their relationships with others. With support from fellow campers, they explored ways to solve their problems with the openness and sensitivity they had acquired at camp.
And I'm gonna have a talk with my parents when I get home.
They also discussed doing something about the racism and sexism they were sure to face in their own communities.
It doesn't stop here. This is where we learn all these things, and down the hill is where we apply what we've learned.
That evening, they celebrated the week with a show. The youth leaders imitated the staff.
And I want to know where that's coming from for you.
And the staff imitated the campers. Even Dan got up there with some of his new friends.
Born to be wild.
Handsome, caring,
honest.
The next morning, the dialogue group gave each member a goodbye memento, a list of the qualities they'd found in them that week. Then they got ready to part.
Just think about what's happened to us in those 7 days, what you did to make that happen, so that you could be this multicultural community.
This experience is a heart-lifting, emotional, very positive experience.
I feel a lot richer, you know? Not in many things, just inside of me.
I feel like I'm a different person.
We don't just turn them loose. We have follow-up programs, we have a reunion. This has been a wonderful camp.
Some of the campers will be back as youth leaders next year. Others will start groups at their schools, hoping to pass along some of the insights they've gained. But every one of them will hold this experience in his or her heart forever, knowing that nothing will ever be the same again.
Time it was, and what a time it was, it was. A time of innocence, a time of confidences. Long ago it must be, I have a photograph. Preserve your memories, they're all that's left you.